Allen. You can join us here every Tuesday at 12:30 for your weekly news roundup and a discussion of current events. Feel free to comment and ask us questions in the field below. So, Allen,
yes.
remember a few weeks ago that twerp in D.C. who thinks that Rothschilds...
There's a lot of twerps in D.C., by the way.
This particular one thinks that the Rothschilds control the weather.
Yes.
Yeah, that one. So yes. He's still out there being really peculiar.
Yeah, he's a peculiar guy. Trayon White Sr. The Washington, D.C. councilman, said twerp, who suggested on Facebook that rich Jews control the weather, visited the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum and left halfway through the 90-minute tour. Guess he was bored.
Guess so.
Trayon White Sr., or busy. Trayon White Sr. did not say goodbye to his hosts, according to the Washington Post. Rabbi Batya Glazer of the Jewish Community Relations Council of Greater Washington, who accompanied Mr. White on the April 18th tour, texted him to ask, "Where are you?" to ask his whereabouts. White wrote back that he hoped to see her outside the museum, but he had to leave soon for an event in the 8th Ward, which he represents.
Uh-huh.
White was standing alone on the sidewalk outside the museum by the time the tour was over.
Okay.
Glazer said she found his behavior quite confusing.
As do I.
During the visit, White reportedly was confused himself by a picture of a woman surrounded by Nazis while wearing a sign that reads, quote, "I'm a German girl and allowed myself to be defiled by a Jew." He asked twice whether the Nazis were protecting her before the guide explained that they were just trying to humiliate her. A lot of confusion there.
This guy is a mess. He's seriously lost. First of all, if you've been to the Holocaust Museum, you know that they sort of shuttle you through.
Right.
It's kind of awkward and difficult to just stop in the middle.
Right.
You would have to, it's like if you're in a line for like a roller coaster, mm-hmm. you don't just get out of that line. At that point, you might as well go on the roller coaster.
Well, here's a newsflash. I don't think he wanted to be there.
Well,
did not want to be there. He did it to shut up some Jewish folks and he did his thing, but he had other things to tend to, and you know, like a lot of politicians, they leave midway.
But he didn't go anywhere. He was just outside. He just didn't want to be inside.
Right.
And I get if it like
upset
him. Well,
the reception in there is not that good.
Oh, he couldn't text?
I'm just joking.
He's a twerp. He's such a twerp. He needs fixing. Somebody needs to help this person in a way that resonates.
Well, just the fact that he thinks that a family dictates the weather.
Well, he did apologize for that at some point. I haven't heard any apologies for not sticking through a 90-minute tour at the Holocaust Museum.
It's right
there's
up there
just
with making
much.
Out during Schindler's List, or something.
Which I still find
for you
hilarious.
Seinfeld fans out there.
I just think that's like the funniest thing ever. Okay, so anyway, there's some very troublesome news coming out of Philly.
Yeah, Temple University, the Alpha Epsilon Pi fraternity, a traditionally Jewish fraternity at Temple, was suspended on April 21st as police investigate allegations by two 19-year-olds who said they were sexually assaulted at two different parties at the fraternity house. Both students came forward this month, and a third student has come forward but has not yet been interviewed by police, according to the Associated Press. Additionally, Temple Police is investigating multiple credible reports of sexual assault, sexual misconduct, drug and excessive alcohol use that were reported at AEPI, according to the student newspaper. So they're just, you know, they're just dispelling any stereotypes we all have of
about frat boys.
Yeah.
Boys. It's really helping with the image. Also, not good, everybody. Not good. We already did this once this year. Let's move on. Let's elevate.
Well, it just shows you the Jewish frat boys are no different than non-Jewish frat boys.
They're all
Islamic frat boys. Hindu frat boys.
They're
all the same.
Just better. Just be
boys
better.
Boys just want to have fun.
God. All right. If you're just joining us, this is Jay Moore's Need to Know on Facebook Live. Share, like, and follow at hashtag Jay Moore Need to Know. So Natalie Portman is presently the girl who kicked the hornet's nest. Check her out.
This is just an amazing story because you're talking about the darling of the Jewish cultural world.
People
love her, and the organized Jewish community is in a tailspin over this, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Or people are very upset about it. Of course, Natalie is a Jerusalem native, Oscar winner as well.
Mm-hmm.
But she will no longer get to choose where her $2 million Genesis Prize will be donated after saying that she will not travel to Israel to receive the award.
Mm-hmm.
Portman is refusing to travel to the Jewish state to receive the prize because, quote, recent events in Israel have been extremely distressing to her, and she does not feel comfortable participating in any public events in Israel, the foundation announced on April 19th. It has canceled the award ceremony in June as a result. The prize, which is known as the Jewish Nobel, has been awarded annually for 5 years. Every winner has pledged to donate the $2 million award money. Portman says she would be donating to her award to women's rights groups. The Genesis Prize Foundation will still give the money to those groups. By the way, she was at the Women's March last year, wasn't she?
I believe she was.
She spoke there.
I think she was. I think I remember that.
Yeah, she did, because she even talked about sexual abuse in Hollywood. I remember a story about her and sexual abuse.
I don't remember actually hearing her, but it was crazy. I don't know.
So, meanwhile, the foundation will still give the money to those groups, but Portman will no longer get to choose the recipients owing to her refusal to attend this award ceremony, according to a statement by Israeli philanthropist Maris Khan, who supplied half of this year's award.
This
is seismic for Jews who take great pride in her, and of course she has a strong Israeli connection.
Yeah.
And people are upset.
She's been known as like a representative.
I'm sure a lot of people are very proud of her and feel like she's taking a stand about the Netanyahu administration's policies and a lot of things that have gone on in Gaza recently. So I'm sure some people are happy and some people are saying, you know, it's fine to have your opinions, but maybe not show it off to the entire world.
I think that's exactly what she should do, especially with this grant. I mean, why give someone a Nobel?
I'm just telling you how some people feel. An alleged
Nobel Prize, or well, not alleged, a Jewy Nobel.
Right.
Which a lot of Nobel winners are already Jewish, but whatever.
Right.
Why give them one if you don't want them to like use that opportunity to have a soapbox or right. have a position?
Well, it's like during the Intifada of the late 80s, the Palestinian uprising, and Woody Allen wrote an op-ed in the New York Times, and a lot of Jews were upset about it because he condemned Israel at the time and took advantage of his Jewish high Jewish profile to speak about things. So,
wow. Yeah.
Some people appreciated it, and some people said, you know, it's fine to feel that way, but let's keep it in the family.
Right.
So that's something that roils a lot of ethnic communities, I think.
Yeah. All right. Well, also in Israel, we have the latest on the African migrant situation. Another bad thing going on there.
Well, 18 Jewish Democrats out of 21 in the House of Representatives wrote to Israeli Prime Minister Netanyahu to say that they were dismayed and disappointed over his retreat from a plan that replaced his earlier proposal to deport tens of thousands of African migrants from Israel. The letter said the lawmakers were heartened on April 2nd when they learned that Netanyahu had worked out a plan with the United Nations, only to hear within hours that he had reversed himself, according to our partners JTA. We were dismayed to hear the agreement had been suspended, then canceled, leaving the Sudanese and Eritrean asylum seekers in limbo with no clear next step, said the letter sent April 23rd and initiated by four of the top Jewish lawmakers, Representatives Nita Lowey of New York, Elliot Engel of New York also, Ted Deutsch of Florida, and Sandra Levin of Michigan, all Jewish Democrats. The lawmakers said that they were writing as Jewish congresspeople, and also on behalf of their constituents. The majority of the lawmakers represent districts with substantive Jewish communities. Many of us have heard in recent months from constituents who deeply care about Israel and who are gravely concerned with the respect to the future of the approximately 38,000 asylum seekers living in the Jewish state, according to the letter. Among those who signed the letter was Maryland's Representative Jamie Raskin. So these folks are taking a stand.
Somebody, yeah. Keep taking stands. Let's all just stand. In other magical disappearing
Be careful what you wish for.
News. True. So.
Yes, magic news.
Magic news.
Magician David Copperfield was forced to reveal the secret behind one of his most famous tricks in court this week. The 61-year-old illusionist from New Jersey, who, yes, is Jewish, is being sued for negligence by a British man who claims to have been injured while taking part in one of his shows at the MGM Grand Hotel in 2013 in Las Vegas, according to the New York Post. Copperfield's executive producer, Chris Kenner, took the stand April 17th in Las Vegas and disclosed how the trick in question, which is dubbed Lucky 13, how it's done. Revealing it from start to finish, he described how Copperfield chooses 13 audience members at random, closes them in a room, and then uses aids and a set of secret passageways to lead them back into their seats. The man who was injured, Gavin Cox, claims he fell while being guided through the passageways and suffered brain and body injuries. He alleges that the hallways were filled with construction dust and other debris, which made them very difficult to navigate. A former chef for the British royal family, Cox claims that his medical bills totaled more than $400,000 and that his injuries will plague him for the rest of his life. Of course, I know he's probably very excited about Prince Harry's upcoming nuptials and the new royal baby.
There's a new baby, yeah. Third.
Making headlines everywhere for no discernible reason.
I never care about the royal babies. It's like my least favorite thing right after other stuff.
I agree.
So anyway.
People care.
I don't understand this story at all. First of all, what is the magic trick that was revealed? Because like putting 13 random audience members into a room and then getting them back to their seats, like what part of this was more to it than that. I don't understand. And they didn't just magically like reappear in their seats. The passageways couldn't have been right under their seats.
You're talking about the guy who made the Statue of Liberty disappear.
Which was awesome. I became a super fan after that.
Okay.
And I always had to go see him. I know when I first I didn't disappear and go down any passageways.
You were one of the lucky.
But when I first moved here, me and my mom were living in Reservoir Hill.
Right.
And we had tickets for his show. I was like
Temple Gardens.
Yes,
right?
Exactly. Temple Gardens Apartments. Shout out.
Why I remember that.
It was awesome. But we had tickets for a show, and there was a snowstorm that night. And I was begging my mom. I was like, I have to go see him. It was at the Lyric. And it was a snowstorm, and there was snow everywhere, but they didn't cancel the show. Me and my mom walked from Reservoir Hill down to the Lyric.
Wow.
Yeah, to get there to see the show. That's what my mom did for me.
That's a little bit of a schlep.
It was a schlep, but I had to go to the stupid show.
What a wonderful mom.
Right? Vivian. But so we did that, and it was awesome. But I was like a super fan.
Wow.
I know.
Well, he's got fans all over the world. People love him.
He does amazing magic, except when he
made the Statue of Liberty disappear.
And here's the other thing. What, like, you only can perform in a place that has lots of secret passageways? Why would some place have a secret passageway? I understand backstage.
A lot of theaters do, right?
But this doesn't sound like backstage. It sounds like some complicated secret passageways. We have one right behind here. Don't tell anyone because it's a secret, but we have a secet passageway. And one day if I disappear, it's because I used our secret passageway. Poof! Where'd that random employee
go?
So tell me what you told me earlier about Houdini.
Oh, yeah. Well, speaking of magicians, Houdini is coming to the Jewish Museum of Maryland. The museum is doing one of their wonderful exhibitions, and this is really out of the box. He's a fascinating character. He was the first American superstar, son of a rabbi. I think he came here as an infant from Germany and grew up in Appleton, Wisconsin, of all places. Father was a rabbi and died when he was young. But Houdini had an incredible life, and, of course, Tony Curtis played him in the movie.
I should watch that.
It's not a very good one.
It's not good.
It got a lot of things wrong, it turned out.
Oh.
It was a 50s biopic.
Yeah.
But the museum, I'm sure, will do a great job with it, and I think it's going to get a lot of buzz because it's just a little different.
It sounds really cool.
And he's still we're almost 100 years after his passing. Died in 1926. But people are still fascinated by
him. Yeah, there's like mystery surrounding him.
Yeah.
No, I want to go to that show. That sounds great.
I'm sure it's going to be a good show. And, and of course, Jay Moore will be covering it. We'll be doing a story about it. So it should be really great. So speaking of David Copperfield and magic.
Yes. All right.
So go see it.
Abracadabra.
I think it starts June 24th, by the way, the exhibition.
Really? Yeah. I'm so there. Give us a J word.
Okay. The J word is Hamish, a Yiddish word which means cozy, warm, or having friendly characteristics.
I'm not so Hamish.
Her new home was very Hamish. It was a very welcoming place to hang out. And I got to say, this is a word I use a lot.
You do? Just like constantly calling things Hamish?
The shul is Hamish, or he has a Hamish place.
You never probably said it about me. You were never like that, Amanda Kratky.
She's
so
un-Hamish.
I am the reverse Hamish. I need to find a nice Hamish home to go live in. Before we go.
Yes.
Nothing to see here, right?
Okay.
Nothing up my sleeve. I'm going to reveal something. I got tricks up my sleeve. We are publishing a special JBiz issue in June.
We are. Wow.
Surprise. And it's all about Jewish entrepreneurs.
Yep.
So in conjunction with that project, JBiz's guest editor, Betsy Boyd, will be taking over Need to Know on Facebook Live on May 8th, 15th, 22nd, and 29th.
But her cat, Stan, will not be there.
So you can tune in next week when we will reveal the lineup of
Stan, the international celebrity.
Special guests. Additionally, he's trying to get my goat. Additionally, we will be hosting a related networking event on June 13th, and you can find out more about that at jmoreliving.com/jbiztics. It's going to be a really good party, so you definitely want to be there for that. Remember to join us here Tuesdays at 12:30 for your Need to Know News Roundup. Tune into Facebook Live to join the conversation. Don't forget to comment, like, share, and follow at #jmoreneedtoknow. Go to jmoreliving.com for more news updates, and happy birthday, Barbara Streisand!
Wow. How old is she?
I don't know, 70?
I think she's well into her 70s. Well, either way,
someone
happy
tell
birthday.
Us, whatever. Happy birthday.
A lady never reveals, right?
Right. Okay, have a good week.
Bye.